This is the Department of Chemistry of the Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology, Kumasi in Ghana. The Department of Chemistry is as old as the university itself. Since its humble inception in 1961, the department has grown steadily in student numbers over the decades to the current student population of about 580, about 10% of whom are postgraduate students, making it the largest mainstream chemistry department in Ghana and probably in West Africa. The department has set for itself the task of educating the next generation of chemists with the capacity to solve real problems and provide leadership that can lead to the economic and social transformation of Ghana, Africa and the world, a task it discharged so creditably since its inception. The department is home to very highly qualified faculty and extremely motivated students. The department offers a 4-year Bachelor of Science degree program, a 2-year Master of Philosophy degree program, and a 3-year PhD program. Our training program provides a unique combination of manual, theoretical, analytical, numerical, and problem-solving skills for our students. Our researchers are operating at the frontiers of their chosen fields of expertise, not only in the traditional areas of chemistry, that's analytical, inorganic, organic and physical chemistry, but also in multidisciplinary research areas, as well as in new and emerging areas of chemistry, such as medicinal chemistry, chemical biology, polymer chemistry, and computational chemistry, emphasizing the central role of chemistry in the natural sciences.
I had my PhD specifically in experimental investigation of protein-ligand interaction. We used a computerized software that predicted new and uncharacterized interaction of proteins of biological interest with ligands. And we did experimental work to confirm the predicted interaction. After my PhD, I did a postdoc in the laboratory of one of the top 3 developmental biologists in dentition. She's called Reina D'Souza, where I was introduced to molecular biology techniques, recombinant protein, recombinant plasmids, tissue and cell culture, as well as other related immunohistochemistry, as well as other related molecular biology techniques. And that provided the background for my second postdoc into cancer biology in James Graham Brown Cancer Center at Louisville, Kentucky, where I worked with Wolfgang Zacharias, who was in charge of the microarray facility of James Graham Brown Cancer Center. So we did a lot of transcriptomic work. It was our bread and butter. And we assessed cystatin expression in malignant progression and cathepsin expression also in malignant progression of oral cancer tissues. We've been isolating and assessing the antimicrobial activities of the secondary metabolites from pure cultured fungi. And I think we would like to try the extracts on an endemic disease like Borrelia ulcer, as well as other tropical diseases. We would also, with my training in cancer biology and in cell culture, I would also like to culture cancer cells specifically from people of African descent. This will provide needed cells for genetic analysis into the genetic underpinning of malignant progression, particularly specific certain strains of breast cancer as well as prostate cancer that are known to affect people of African descent disproportionately. Yeah, the OMIC represents some of the novel concepts that has been become an integral part of modern drug discovery. And the role of chemistry cannot be overemphasized. Genomics actually links natural products with the genome of the plants and microbes that produce it. Transcriptomics and proteomics relates genes and novel isoforms of the gene and isoforms of the gene that are amenable to drug, rational drug design. Metagenomics provides unparalleled access to the rich chemical diversity of chemical compounds that are available or that can be accessed from uncultured microbes. But most importantly, metabolomics builds upon an organic chemistry knowledge base in both concept and in methodology. Most of the instrumentation are regular instrumentations that is used in analytical chemistry, and most of the concepts literally relates to the organic chemistry of metabolic pathway. So these provide new career options for students who are interested in a professional career in organic chemistry and in the life sciences.
I am a bioorganic chemist. I have my PhD at the University of Massachusetts in Amherst. At the University of Massachusetts, my PhD work involved designing novel tools for interrogating the biosynthesis of polyketides. It involved designing small organic molecules that were very, very reactive and could be used to label specific sites on the polyketide protein. In graduate school, I designed novel small molecules to interrogate biological systems. Currently, my focus has shifted a little bit, even though it still remains at the interface of chemistry and biology. I am currently looking at bioactive compounds from nature. I am looking at organisms from the sea. I am looking at organisms on the terrestrial environment. However, the first issue still remains outstanding: funding. Researchers in Ghana need money to do their work. We need to be creative in sourcing for funds. Even though we can still look for external sources of funding, it's important that the government of Ghana and industries in Ghana actually come in to support the kind of work that we are doing. The onus is also rest on us. We also have to make sure that our research is tailored towards solving the problems of Ghana. We have to make sure that our research is relevant to Ghana, to the development of Ghana, and to whatever happens in Ghana. That way, it will be easier for government, for private organizations in Ghana, and for industries in Ghana to fund the work that we do.
I'm full of organic chemistry and natural products student at the Department of Chemistry, KNUST. My research focus is on the study of compounds and substances that have natural origin. Okay, so let's say we have a plant that is used locally or ethnomedically to cure a particular ailment in our local setting. So what we do as organic chemists or natural product chemists is we go out and then we collect these plants and then we do various identification. After identification, we bring them to the lab. We do various forms of extraction. After the extraction, we go and then test for various activities of these plants. Let's say you've heard that or it is being used locally to treat malaria, diarrhea, gonorrhea or something. So what we do is we take this, we perform various extractions and then test out for those activities. Once we get good activities, we do further isolation and then characterization of the compounds that are found in this. And that is basically what we do. So after MPhil studies, I'll further and then do my PhD.
Final year student of chemistry, Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology, and my research work is to explore the bioactivity of crude extracts of some Ghanaian marine mollusks. We collected some mollusk species from the western region and then the Greater Accra region, and we extracted with some organic solvents, and we concentrated the solvents or the extracts into their cool forms, and then we used the well diffusion assay to test for bioactivity, and we obtained special results which we are still working on. So pertaining to what I will do after undergraduate studies, I would like to go to grad school and pursue a course which combines the interface of biology and then chemistry. So it's more going to be like bioorganic chemistry, which aims at sending me to a higher level of rational drug discovery.
One of our most popular and most successful research areas is in analytical and environmental chemistry, where our researchers have been working on the distribution, mobility and speciation of environmental pollutants such as heavy metals and persistent organic pollutants, especially in the aquatic and terrestrial ecosystems, and on the development of analytical methods for these studies.
Basically, I am an analytical environmentalist who deals with chemical analysis, new product development, and environmental toxicology. My research area recently is on the aquatic ecosystem of Ghana, and we center so much on the Volta Lake of Ghana, where we're looking at the environmental compartment, the toxicants in them, especially mercury, which is of a global concern now. I have been involved in looking at toxicants in the aquatic ecosystem. I've done so much work on the Ofin River Basin, the Pra River Basin, and some part of the Ankobra River Basin that have been impacted so much by mining activity.
This is the Computational and Theoretical Chemistry Center of the department. Set up by Professor Evans Adai with a TALIF project grant, the center is dedicated to the development and application of the state-of-the-art computational chemistry techniques to explore nature at the atomic and molecular level. Current research areas are in two broad categories: molecular modeling, where we explore the mechanisms of organic, inorganic, and organometallic reactions. These studies afford important molecular-level mechanistic details of industrially relevant chemical reactions that are difficult, if not impossible, to obtain experimentally. Molecular-level understanding enables chemical reactions to be guided quickly and efficiently along desirable pathways with the effect of producing the right product with minimal energy consumption and minimal environmental impact. Reaction mechanisms are the oxide-supported metal clusters, transport and adsorption in zeolites, surfactant adsorption at mineral sites, materials modeling, where we explore the atomic and molecular level mechanistic insights gained from these studies, are useful for the design of noble catalysts for the conversion of carbon 4 oxide and other greenhouse gases, as well as stranded gases from the petroleum refining, into useful fuels. This addresses the problem of global warming, as well as providing an environmentally friendly alternative source of fuel.
I am a physical and computational chemist. You know, I've always told my students that the wave function is like an oracle that knows all the secrets and the mysteries of the universe and will tell you everything if you ask it nicely. So our job here is to master the art and science of asking those questions and listening to the answers. So the research in this lab is organized under two main things. That is our computational organometallic chemistry and computational material science. In the computational organometallic chemistry, we are looking at homogeneous transition matter catalysts for organic reactions like oxidation, dehydrogenation, and things like that. And then we have the computational materials chemistry bit.
Fourth year graduate students working on computational material science. My project is looking at carbon dioxide reduction on transition metal, specifically iron. I'm looking at how the different facets affect the mechanism. I explore the possible pathways and the most favored pathway on the surface, considering the kinetics and the thermodynamics. And apart from the facets, I also look at how surface modification of iron favors the process, like looking at nickel monolayer deposition and introducing defects to the iron surface and looking at how the energetics are changed. The research has been exciting. It has enlightened me in the area and also given me the opportunity to attend conferences in Ghana and abroad. After this program, I want to continue with a postdoc, and also because I intend to remain in academia and research in materials science.
Third year PhD student in the computational and theoretical chemistry laboratory. I'm working on oxygen reduction on some lanthanum magnide models systems for application in solid oxide fuel cells. Lanthanum magnide is the workhorse cathode. This is because of its relatively cheap cost, its mechanical strength, its ability to catalyze oxygen reduction reaction at a reasonable rate, its robustness. But we know that lanthanum magnide itself is a poor ionic conductor, but a very good electronic conductor. So what has been done over the years is, you either dope the lanthanum magnide with a dopant, or either you infiltrate the surface of the lanthanum magnide with a good ionic conductor. And what my work seeks to address is, conventionally we know of strontium doped lanthanum magnide, but according to Belege et al, calcium doped lanthanum magnide and beryllium doped lanthanum magnide are also other candidate material for application in low temperature solid oxide fuel cell. For instance, the calcium doped lanthanum magnide, because of the small size mismatch in terms of the Shannon ionic radii. So if you have a small ionic mismatch between the dopant and the host cation, you expect the surface of the cathode material to maintain its integrity. In this case, we don't expect the dopant to segregate onto the surface of the cathode, thereby enabling its application in low temperature solid oxide fuel cell. After the PhD, I would want to go to the US for a postdoc and come back to Ghana to train a whole crop of scientists in developing of novel cathode materials for application in solid oxide fuel cell, particularly the low temperature, because at high temperature there are cathode degradation, formation of reducing purpose series, and a whole lot of factors which can't be controlled.
I'm a first year graduate student of the Theoretical and Computational Lab in Chemistry Department here in KNUST, and my research is on conversion of biomass to fuel. I'll be working on lignin, which is contained in lignocellulose and is known to be converted to energy carriers and present like a large terrestrial renewable carbon energy source. And so efforts are being made to utilize the biomass for large-scale production of fuel. Okay, so basically I will be working on, I'll be studying the mechanisms for acid-catalyzed cleavage of the aryl ether linkages, the functional theory calculations. Okay, so my future career plan. Basically, after here, I would like to be a lecturer.
So, researching on
new materials for renewable energy, trying to break lignin down into fine chemicals and fuel. The thing that I like about this area of research is the ability to explore new ideas that come to mind, being able to use the computer to analyze reaction mechanisms and probe into new ideas that come up on your way. You can easily try a lot of interesting ideas that come to mind.
All the students are enjoying what they are doing.
Graduate students studying computational chemistry and material science, and I'm fulfilling my dream, or should I say my obsession, with reticular chemistry by studying zeolites. Now my topic is centered on the conversion of ethanol to long chain olefins using zeolites. Work, as interesting as it may be sometimes, it could get a little bit stressful because, well, I mean, there are frustrations with every venture that one goes into. But it's the interest in the subject matter that keeps us going. What would I like to do after graduate school? I'd say make a little bit of money. Hopefully work for an oil firm, or just get out into the field and then have a feel of stuff, because we've been cooked up in the lab for quite some time, and I think it's about time to just get out there and have some fun.
Even undergraduate students are having fun with molecules and nursing hope of lifelong careers in computational chemistry.
And I am working on transition metal assisted formation of 1,2-dinitrosoalkanes. It is a computational study. And right after undergraduate studies, I will want to further to graduate school right here to pursue further studies on organometallic reactions.
Elizabeth, a final year undergraduate student in chemistry, and I am working in the computational and theoretical chemistry lab, and I'm doing my project on a computational study of the reactions of cyclopentadienyl dinitroso metal complexes with alkane. I hope to continue my master's program in physical chemistry after my first degree.
My pride and joy is in my students, so my task now is to try and make give them the most exciting experience as much as possible in this exciting venture. And so that is essentially what I do.
My intention was to, I told Professor Kufuor that after the service I'll go to Nigeria, make some money and go to Canada to study. So at the end of the first year, I came back a little bit late. So and when you can say, I thought you are going to Nigeria, I said, not yet. So the second year service, getting to the end of the second year, he called me and said, Evans, I'm going to appoint you as an assistant lecturer so that you can do masters on part-time. You have 2 weeks to think about it. They didn't like it. So one day, Edimado had just come from Nigeria. So one morning, he took me to Edimado's office. And then, say, Tony, give Evan some master's work to do. That's how, finally, two of us were selected after GRE, subject test, general test, and then TOEFL. Two of us were selected. Myself and then Opari. Opari was from Cape Coast, economics. So we went that year. So I was given a 5-year grant without a school. So I think Institute of International Education in America got me a school, State University of New York, at Binghamton. Ali Muzuri was there. When I went, I met Ali Muzuri. He was making a documentary on Africa. And then Edubuahini, at that time, was spending some sabbatical in that university. They had a very strong political science department. So I was there. We didn't know I was in New York. But fortunately for me, the theoretician had left that year. So Professor Lees was trying to talk me into doing inorganic. Because I think I had done well in their exam. You know, you do some exam before they decide on where to place you. So but I was bent on doing theory. When my mates heard that I was going to do theoretical chemistry, they said, Evans, are you crazy? So I went to the library, looked for
the Big Short. I wanted to work for the Big Short. They, I saw, came across Journal of Computational Chemistry. Popo was one of the editors, very old at the time. And then Kaplas was also one of the editors, and then Warren Harry. But as soon as I saw Warren Harry's infectious smile, I told myself that I'll work for this guy. So I wrote to him that I have a Fulbright grant. I'm presently in SUNY Binghamton, that I have recognized him as one of the Big Shots in the area of theoretical and computational chemistry. So I'm prepared to remedy any deficiency I have to complete the program PhD under his supervision. And so I graduated in 1996, and then came back June to resume work. Talif gave me $184,000. That was a lot of money. You can imagine my excitement, a dream. We are training the next generation because I'm old. So right now I become redundant in the lab. Sooner or later, I will leave the scene. But we have to have people who are ready when the country is ready to harness the capacity we have for our development. And it's not too good sending all our first class, because all our first class guys go abroad to do first class research. And one may say that, okay, we can wait and then just tap the technology there and then use it in this country. Failing to realize that you have to have the support base. You have to have people here who can understand the high tech to be able to interpret.
This is the research laboratory of Dr. Mercy Badu, recipient of prestigious Laurel UNESCO Regional Fellowship for Women in Science Award, a competitive award given to selected women with potential to make great strides in the field of science. The lab was established from this grant, as well as with the assistance of Professors Stephen Yates and Peter Bard of the University of Manchester, UK.
So October 2014, we had this lab. This lab actually was facilitated by the award that was won from the Laurel UNESCO for Women in Science Fellowship for motion systems, which will have the great functionality in delivery of especially pharmaceutical compounds. So that we have very, so most of the time we have water-insoluble compounds which are used in the pharmaceutical industry. And due to their instability processes, we have several challenges administering them for patients. And then a system, a collider system, where you would have the insoluble compound dispersed in or solubilized in a non-polar system, which is the oil, and now having it in the aqueous phase. So we can study how the interfacial properties will work for us to get a stable system. And once you have the insoluble compound now dissolved in the oil phase, once it is taken or it's administered, it's expected that the oil is going to go through digestion, and so the ease of absorption into the body system. And so basically that is what I have been doing for the past few years, and then I'm trying to see how I can also incorporate natural products, things that are very easy and common to come by in Ghana especially. So we have our natural products, so I'm looking at vegetable oils, vegetable fats, and all these are supposed to disperse in an aqueous medium and have them solubilized or stable so that we can use them for drug delivery. This lab was put together from a grant award that was won from the Laurel UNESCO Award for Women in Science in Sub-Saharan Africa. This award actually recognizes the hard work of female scientists from Sub-Saharan Africa who are trying to pursue science at the highest education level. A second-year postgraduate student in polymer science and technology at the Department of Chemistry, KNUST. I'm currently studying the migration kinetics of residual styrene monomers in expanded polystyrene packaging materials into vegetable oil. And the use of these expanded polystyrene packaging materials are becoming increasingly popular. And it has been established that they contain residual monomers. Recently, styrene was classified by the National Toxicology Panel as reasonably anticipated to be a human carcinogen. And other researchers have also shown that this styrene monomers has a toxic effect on the liver and can also affect the central nervous system. So the fact that these styrenes affect humans in a number of ways raises concerns and therefore needs attention. Immediately after my MPhil degree, I'll continue with my PhD.
Our undergraduates are passionate about their studies.
I came here feeling like a fish out of water, but now completely at home. I love organic chemistry. I love how so many things can be synthesized from scratch. And when you're a student and you're in the lab and you're doing all these reactions, it makes you feel like you can create anything. After my undergraduate studies, I would most definitely like to continue with graduate studies. Ultimately, I want to be a doctor. I know it's a long shot, but I'm sure this is a perfect starting ground.
The department has developed an international reputation. Students from other African countries come here to be educated.
My name is Betty Osobuda. I'm a Nigerian and my final year student of chemistry in KNUST. My project is on analysis of trace elements in leafy vegetables. And I've been working with four vegetables, bitter leaf, ayoyo leaf, goma leaf, and cocoyam leaf. Studying in Ghana has been different from how I knew it in Nigeria, but I think that's also helped me because it has challenged me to work harder, you know, to be able to fit to the standard. So I would like to go into medicinal chemistry, so I plan to go to graduate school, maybe to study pharmaceutical chemistry.
My name is Joshua Babajide Kumo. I'm a Nigerian. My final year project is on safe disposal of obsolete chemicals. Chemistry in this department has given me the right tools, the right foundation for me to be a better doctor.
My name is Ebel Lauman. I'm a third year chemistry student at KNUST. At first I thought that studying outside my country was difficult. But coming at KNUST, I just began to study. And now, after I adapted myself to the environment, I can ensure.
Our graduates are confident young men and women who are poised to take on the world.
I'm a teaching and research assistant in the Department of Chemistry. I graduated in the year 2015. It's a BSc First Class Honors in Chemistry. My project was actually on the blocking of fatty acid oxidation pathway in living cells, which is to study the competitive inhibition of fatty acids with coenzyme A, as well as some selected inhibitors with coenzyme A. This actually was done using computer simulation to check for the energetics of the reactions of coenzyme A and carnitine with fatty acid, as well as the coenzyme A and carnitine with some selected inhibitors of fatty acid oxidation. And based on their energetics, draw conclusion as to how they are able to block the fatty acid oxidation pathway of the process, as well as propose a mechanism for that process to take place.
I'm a teaching assistant in the chemistry department. I graduated in 2015, my first class on SCPS in chemistry. For my undergraduate project and thesis work, I worked on how fungi can serve as potentially new sources of antimicrobial and antioxidant drugs, and I worked on the fungi. My project got me interested in biological chemistry, and after school I would like to pursue my master's and doctorate degrees in biological chemistry as well.
Hello, my name is Ebel Okanzi and I'm a current graduate of the KNUST Department of Chemistry. Studying for my undergraduate degree in chemistry from KNUST here has been very exciting. In terms of what you're exposed to as an undergraduate student, the kinds of subjects and concepts that you're introduced to, it makes you open up your perception to what other people are doing elsewhere. Studying chemistry has opened my eyes to a wide variety of science out there. As of now, I'm carrying out research on studying the antimicrobial properties of certain plants. But I've also carried out research on various other samples, for instance, to test for contaminants, perhaps metal contaminants in certain samples that people bring. So I would like to get a terminal degree, perhaps so my PhD in chemistry, preferably organic chemistry or inorganic chemistry.
I'm an alumni of the chemistry department here in KNUST. I completed in 2014. So after my undergraduate studies, I came back to the department as a teaching and research assistant. It was a really nice experience for me being a teaching assistant. And as a research assistant, I worked in the lab of Dr. Lawrence Bogwe of this department, and I did so many things. Mainly what I did was to determine adulterants in herbal medicines, local herbal medicines. And I gained experience in some tools like GCMS and then HPLC, which was actually fun for me to get hands-on experience in some of these things. The plan for me has actually always been to push myself to the limit, and now I'm getting ready and preparing to go to graduate school to pursue my PhD.
Another unique feature of the department is the weekly departmental seminar. The departmental seminar is an avenue for researchers to share their research with the rest of the family. With such dedicated academic staff and motivated students, the future of the department is bright indeed.